Good morning. You're probably wondering, where's my handout? And there was one, and a couple of you may have it, but I got here real early this morning and picked those up, put them back in my office, because God changed directions last night on me, and I knew it was coming, and because God gets my attention a lot of times at night when I'm trying to sleep, and maybe I've not heard him during the day. Maybe it's a thing I'm too busy, and I'm not listening as well. But when you go to lay down, you're trying to get quiet, and you get still, and God had a different direction. I am so appreciative that, well, first let me ask you this. How many of us in here have problems? Come on now, raise it up good and high. How many of you have problems? Now, keep them up there because I want everybody to look around. If you see anybody that's not got their arms up, at least one, some of us probably need to have both of them up. We expect you in the altar if you don't have your arms up right now before the service is over with. But you know what? I'm thankful that I am not part of a perfect church. I'm really thankful for that. I'm never going to be perfect in my preaching. Gosh, I want to be. I want to give the perfect message. I want to preach it perfectly. I want to be outstanding, not for me, but I want people to know Jesus, and I don't want to get in the way of that. And as I said earlier, our church is under attack. You just look around, and I'll just take our staff and our stage presence with the people that our band and stuff like that. If we were not doing what God wanted us to do, and we were just doing what we wanted to do, or disregarding God's direction and not focused on Him, there wouldn't be a single attack in this church, because Satan would have us right where he wanted us, doing what he wanted us to do, or not necessarily not doing anything, but just being ineffective. And so through the hard times and through the attacks, I'm thankful that I can go back to the fact that I know that we're about God's business. I look at so much that's going on, and especially this morning, I had that perfect sermon planned this morning. And then I think God says, oh, no, you didn't. I got a different direction. And I know we're on the right path. Carrie, this past week, it's been crazy at your house, Carrie. I look at the other band members here, the things that are going on with them, health, other things. I look at Trent this morning, caught up in traffic, cannot get through traffic to get here. So practice time was affected by that. But the band was in here and they went ahead and didn't stop and say, we can't do because you know, Satan's attacking us, we can't do. They moved forward and they kept going even though they met that resistance. And I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful that we have a church that is doing that. Wednesday, and really if I think back this week, I'm sorry. I'm a little emotional this morning. But I think God started planning this Wednesday. And I was sitting in here along with other people as John, the first Wednesdays of the month, he teaches about church history. And this past week, he talked about George Whitfield, a great, great preacher, who you've heard me say that I'll preach three or four times on Saturday and three or four times on Sunday before I want to build another building. I say that jokingly, and then he talks about George Whitfield, who preached up to 25 times a week. And I'm like, golly, Marty. Over 30,000 sermons he preached. That's correct, John, in that number there. Over 30,000 sermons. And his message was always the same. A message of repentance. And how important that was. We look at John the Baptist. Simple message. That of repentance. Turning away from the direction you're on and heading an opposite direction and heading straight to God. And then we come to last night, or yesterday. And we know what goes on Saturday, ball games during football season. I watched a little bit of some games, but then I flipped over to social media to see what the response is to everybody's. It's depressing. And I think this morning I put on social media, and I'm going to paraphrase this, that so many people are concerned of the actions, temporary actions of 22 people on any given Saturday, but don't give much thought to eternal results of an empty tomb on Sunday. And how important, if you think about this, what if it was left up to us to tell people about Jesus? And it is left up to us. But what if those people sitting around us, their location of eternity, depending on us sharing, and we were held responsible for that? And people sitting here, if you look at statistics, I think Billy Graham once said that one out of every eight people sitting on a pew in your church is lost and going to hell, even though they may be there every Sunday. And then we can say, why is that? Why is that? Well, they've not heard the gospel. People have not heard the gospel. It is so important that we share the love of Jesus. It's so important. I wished I could this morning. Scotty would kill me. But just rip this screen down so you can see the cross. So that we could point people to Jesus and what he did on the cross for us. What if my grandchildren's eternity depended on what I say to them? Do I point them to Jesus? What if your kids' eternity depended on you to point them to Jesus? What if that coworker that you're, or your best friend, their eternity depended on you telling them about Jesus? So this morning, a simple message. And I just want to ask you about five questions. I don't want you to raise your hand or shout out, unless you want to. My first question to you this morning is, do you have any spiritual beliefs? Do you have any? And what are they? My second question to you this morning is, to you, who is Jesus? The third one is, do you think there's a heaven and hell? Number four, if you died right now, right this moment, where would you go? And why? Number five, if what you believe right now were not true, would you want to know it? I look at our music set this morning. God so loved. That's why I know God was planning this. You're my all in all. Wonderful grace of Jesus.
Oh, how marvelous.
Give me Jesus. So we're just going straight to the invitation this morning, because I believe the message has already been preached and what we've sang this morning. So if you will, thinking about those five questions, turn in your Bible to Romans, the 3rd chapter, the 23rd verse. Romans, the 23rd verse. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Pretty simple message there. Now, flip over to the right to the 6th chapter. And the 23rd verse. For the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And every Bible that I have, if I've not done it yet, when I open that particular Bible, I circle wages. And I put payment. And on death, I mark it out. And I write below it or above it, hell. For the payment of sin is hell. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let's go back to the left to John, the 3rd chapter. Third verse. Jesus is talking to Nicodemus here. He said, Jesus answered him, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And let's keep going. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Now, let's go to the right, John, the 14th chapter. And there, Nicodemus came to Jesus, and Jesus told him, before you can see the kingdom of heaven, before you can get there, before you can enter, you must be born again. 14th chapter of John. In the 6th verse. Probably know this by heart, some of us. Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Verse 7, if you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you do know him and you've seen him. Jesus is God on earth. Jesus, God has revealed himself through his Son Jesus. Turn to Romans. The 10th chapter. The 10th chapter of Romans, the 9th through the 11th verse. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Doesn't say you might, doesn't say maybe, it says will. It says you will be saved. Verse 10, for with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For the scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. Everyone, not just some, not just some certain race, not some nationality, not just some denomination, but it says everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. Now go to the end of the book. Revelation, third chapter. Third chapter of Revelation, 20th verse. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and eat with him and he with me. My favorite translation of that is the New Living Translation. I don't know if anybody has that in here, but it's incredible the way it reads. And it basically says this, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him as friends, like a friend. I will have relationship with him. I will be in relationship with him. The key there is somebody's knocking at the door. I don't know about you, but at my house, if somebody knocks on the door, I have a choice. I can open it or not. Just the other day, I'm painting one of the upstairs rooms in our house, and I hear somebody knocking on the door. I see a car pull up in the front, and I'm like, I don't know who that car is. I hear a knock on the door. I'm like, I'm not going to the door. And I look out the window, and I recognized who it was. And I yelled out, wait just a minute, I'm coming. And it was a former neighbor of ours who's moved back to Knoxville and came by to see us. You see, Jesus is knocking. And you have a choice to open the door or not. And I think some of us are there to where we hear the knock and maybe we look outside. Oh, that's Jesus. I got time. He'll come back tomorrow. He'll come back next week. Look at me. I look horrible. I'm nasty. I'm dirty. I'm smelly. I'm not good enough. He'll come back and I'll be better prepared for a visitor. You're never going to be. Jesus is knocking at the door this morning. Now, flip over to Acts, the 17th chapter. The 30 and 31st verse. Acts 17, 30, 31. The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. Because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. I'm going to read that again. The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. Church, he's calling us to repentance. Church, God is calling you and me to repentance. because he's fixed a day on which he would judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he's appointed, who God appointed. And of this, he has given the assurance to all by raising him from the dead. That one guy who had the power and the ability to get up from the dead and to walk out of a tomb. God has given the ability to judge righteously. But God is saying, repent. Church, God is saying, repent. God is saying, be saved. Because it doesn't say, if I go back and I look at that again, verse 31, because he's fixed a day. What I glean from that is that he didn't say what day. He just says there's a day. And for each of us, it's different. My day may come this afternoon, yours too. It may come next week. It may come 10 years from now. But according to that scripture, it's coming. It's coming. Begging you this morning, don't wait. Your salvation is at stake this morning. And maybe you've already done that. I'm so thankful. But maybe there's somebody you know that hasn't. Church, are we going to tell them? Are we going to risk being ridiculed? Are we going to risk being laughed at? Listen, eternity is too valuable for us to worry about what other people think about us. The eternity of my friends and my family is too important for me to worry about what society says about me or says about you. And I don't know if you realize it. I just shared the gospel with you. Very plain and very simple, and I let the scripture do the talking. It wasn't Marty. So here's what I want to ask you now. Are you a sinner? Scripture spoke to that. Scripture said we all are. Next question. Do you want forgiveness from your sins? Believe Jesus died on the cross and rose again. Two biggest questions. Are you willing to surrender yourself to Christ this morning? And are you ready to invite him into your heart? Into your life. One of those songs earlier. The boasting of sin, the boasting of the grave, and the boasting of hell. Jesus got up and walked out of the grave and said, I've had enough of the boasting. Jesus says, church, you, me, we have victory over death. We have victory over hell. We have victory over the grave. Oh, yeah. One day they're going to lay me down in a tomb, in a grave. But I know where I'm going. I'm not afraid of that. Because I know where my eternity is this morning. I know where my hope is. Church, I'm begging you this morning, come to Jesus. If you've not done that, I don't know if you also heard what I read. You're no longer ignorant to it because I just shared it with you. It's on you now. It's not on me. It's not on Jesus. It's on you. What are you going to do with Jesus this morning? What are you going to do with your sin? What are you going to do with your eternity? John, come on. This is too important for us to just gloss over. The cross and an empty tomb assured me of my eternity because I made a choice and I chose Jesus. I'm begging you this morning to make that same choice. Come to know Jesus this morning. Will you please stand? This altar is going to be open. The band's going to sing. We're going to sing. We're just going to take our time here, whatever it takes. But I am begging you this morning, please, please, do not put it off. Please come to know Jesus this morning. Eternity, your eternity is at stake. God, thank you. God, you speak to each heart here this morning, God. God, then I just pray that we respond appropriately. We love you so much. In Jesus' name, amen.